Listen, I think somebody once told me in public speaking that you never open with an apology, but then you're always supposed to be on time, and I'm not. So I'll apologize for being late. But it's a great pleasure to see you here, and a special greeting to Jack Hume for founding this great organization, and to Jack Stevens, your executive director, and you're particularly welcome here because since the founding of the Citizens for America, your group has been a faithful soldier in the revolution that we're waging here in Washington. You're unique among non-party organizations that support our common agenda for a stronger, prouder, and freer America, because you alone have a grassroots organization that spans the nation. You can muster troops and local media attention in over 80% of the country's congressional districts. On issue after issue, you can, in a moment, get out beyond the beltway to where the real America is. You know, as I've often said, when you're dealing with Congress, you don't have to make them see the light. Just make them feel the heat. Whenever you hear me say that on television or radio, you'll know I'm thinking of you, because when it comes to making them feel the heat, Citizens for America is our movement's front burner. Now, I know that you're having a changing of the guard right now. Lou Lehrman has stepped down as national chairman. Lou is not only an outstanding leader, he's one of America's most thoughtful voices. His writings on monetary reform, on anti-communist freedom fighters, and on many other issues have been among the most important in our time. And let me tell you, it's like advice from a certain broker. When Lou Lehrman talks, I listen. So Lou, though you're stepping down, I have a feeling it's just to get ready to step up to an even greater future, and that when it comes to Lou Lehrman, we ain't heard nothing yet. Thank you. I can't think of any better choice for replacing Lou than the one you've made, Ambassador Gerald Carmen. As you know, Jerry has just recently left his post as ambassador to the UN in Geneva. I could go on about the great job that he did there, but I thought instead I'd tell you about a great job he did before that. He was our first head of the General Services Administration, which was one of the toughest assignments we had to give when we first came into office. The GSA that Jerry took over was an example of all that can go wrong when government runs things. Serious corruption, bloated payrolls, waste galore, and poor service to boot. The GSA he left 4 years later was widely hailed as one of the best-run federal agencies. I saw a story a while back that Jerry told a reporter on how he did it. And since many of you are in for the Carmen treatment in the months ahead, I thought I'd just sort of get you ready. It seems he went to inspect a warehouse after he took the job with a leaky roof one Saturday early on, just after he'd been appointed. When he got back, he said, I asked the people in charge, wasn't that a pretty poor warehouse? And they agreed it was. Well, then he asked, shouldn't it be closed? And they said, yes. And he said, why don't we? And they said, well, we're going to do a study first. The study was going to cost about $500,000. Jerry said, do I have the power to close it? And they said, yes. And he said, close it. It goes without saying, they did. I'm confident that under Jerry's leadership, the Citizens for America will continue to be an effective voice for a greater America. In the past few years, you've helped make the difference on issues ranging from aid to the freedom fighters in Nicaragua to tax reform. In San Francisco, for example, members of your local chapter got widespread media attention for tax simplification when they taped all the forms of the Internal Revenue Service required together in a chain that wrapped around the front of the IRS building. Well, here in Washington, the smart money was saying that tax reform was an impossible dream. But out in the real America, you were showing that impossible or not, it was the people's dream. And that's the great thing about America. Whenever it's the smart money versus the people win. And my friends, our challenges are just beginning. Last week's Senate election was, of course, a disappointment. farm states where we split the close races, or in the heavy manufacturing states where we did well, but in states where the economy was strong and the Democrats ran on Me Too platforms. One Democratic candidate actually was going around getting introduced as a man who supports the president. I hope he remembers that when he gets to Washington. In the House, we did better than any party has done in its sixth year in the White House since 1866. And in the governor's races, well, never in this century has a party picked up so many seats in its sixth year. Now, I know this isn't a party gathering. I cite these election results not to say something about one party or the other, but to say something about our revolution. And that is that it's strong and getting stronger. The American people spoke clearly last week, as they have for the last 6 years. They want us to continue to keep taxes down. They want us to continue to appoint judges who are tough on crime. They want us to continue to build a strong defense, a defense that means strengthening our own armed services as well as supporting our Democratic allies and friends throughout the world. And they want us to continue with work on a strategic defense against ballistic missiles so that we can one day make ballistic missiles obsolete. And that's what the American people want us to do. That's what we said we're going to do. And that's what we're going to do. Now, of course, some in Congress may not have heard the message, and that's where you come in. We're going to work hard to cooperate with the Congress, and the new leadership has promised to work hard to cooperate with us. But in the next 2 years, we may need to remind some of those fellas up on Capitol Hill just what it is that the real America stands for. I found that some of them are inclined to forget. Could be they're getting old. Every now and then they just seem to fade a bit and start to say things they heard in liberalism's youth, like tax and tax and spend. And a few even talk as if they want to go back to the days of the smooth-holy trade barriers and an army that drills with broomsticks. Well, I know you'll help us make sure they know that the real America doesn't want that. You'll help us continue to build our opportunity society, the kind that has more Americans at work today than ever before in history. There's a figure that was new to me, and maybe it would be new to you, and I'm just going to stick it in here. I never knew that in the figuring statistics on labor, they treat as the total employment pool in America everybody, male and female, from 16 years of age up all the way. And today, 61.3% of that pool is employed, and that's the largest percentage in the history of our nation. We'll continue to work for peace while we support the forces of freedom around the world, and you'll help us continue to support the rule of law here at home. So this is why I've come by today, to thank you for what you've done. Thank you for working toward the goals that you and I share, and to say just 4 words about our revolution. We've only just begun. So thank you all, and God bless you. And I understand there's a fishbowl with some questions someplace here.
Very special?
Yes. November 13th in 1979, I announced I was going to run for the president's
right. President Eisenhower was helped in his relations with the Senate by Lyndon Johnson. Do you believe you can establish a similar relationship with Senator Byrd?
Ain't gonna be easy. I'm sure have a go at it.
When will programs be made to correct our trade imbalance? We streamline and modernize our approach to trade.
We've been doing that, as a matter of fact. the imbalance of trade has been on the import side, and probably due in great part to the value of the dollar, because we're still exporting just about the same as we've been exporting all along. It's the imports that have increased. Now, there is one thing about that trade balance that's always bothered me. They do not include services. And our economy today has a vastly increased service industry and providing those services abroad also, but that does not show up, the return for that, in the trade balance. That is only based on product. And but this thing about what we are doing, we're the first administration that has ever actually brought up 301 cases. Instead of waiting for a particular industry to bring it up, you know, that's the one where they claim unfairness in the foreign competition and then want some action taken on that. Well, we haven't waited for the businesses to do it. We've been looking at where we think there's unfair trade practices on the part of our trading partners, and we've been bringing those cases up ourselves. And we're going to continue. We have gotten, after several years of trying in the economic summits, finally in Japan this last year, we persuaded them to join in a whole review of the GATT process. That's the, you know, the treaty and tariff process, to a reordering of that if necessary, because as we've said, we believe in free trade, but it's got to be fair trade and the playing field's got to be even, and we're not going to stop until we get that done. And where there is an uneven playing field, we're going to play rough.
Thank you. Is it brash to expect a major military breakthrough by the Democratic Nicaraguan resistance before the end of 1987? And I believe that it is vital.
Yes, it is vital. And this is one of the things we regret now about losing the majority we had in the one house. It's going to be that much more difficult to overcome those who just for some reason have dug in their heels with regard to the so-called Contra aid. We believe, and the Contras' goal is not overthrow. The Contras' goal, they were part of the revolution against Somoza also. And they have insisted all they want is the communist organization, the Sandinista organization that was also part of the revolution, and that then took over and expelled the rest and made a one, a totalitarian communist state out of Nicaragua. They want them to restore the original goals of the revolution, a pluralistic society, a democracy. And that's what they're fighting for, is not to march in someday and throw the other fellas out. And we feel that it's just morally sound for us to be supporting them because of that goal. If you aren't aware, during the revolution, the revolutionaries asked the Organization of American States to appeal to Somoza to step down so the killing could stop. And the Organization of American States said, what are the goals of your revolution? And in writing, the goals were presented. Democracy, freedom of speech, freedom of trade unions, free press, all the other things, a pluralistic society. And then the Sandinistas just threw that out the window when they got in, and with the utmost of violence, eliminated as many of the leaders as they could that had been their companions in the revolution. So I think it's morally sound for this country to be giving those freedom fighters a chance to restore those original goals.
Mr. President, will you make the decision to deploy SDI immediately and let technology fill in the gaps after your decision, just as President Kennedy made the decision to send a man to the moon in 1962 and let technology fill in the details so that the dream was fulfilled in 1969?
We are not going to trade away the SDI as long as I am here. Dream is, and I told it to Gorbachev, and that was that the elimination of nuclear weapons, and to begin with the ballistic missiles, those are the destabilizing ones, a world that lives here with the knowledge that somebody can push a button and minutes later people are being blown up. But what I told Gorbachev was that my dream of SDI is that we keep on, and when and if we know that we have the workable program that can be the shield against nuclear ballistic missiles, we complete the job of eliminating those missiles entirely on both sides. And then I told him, we'll share with you. You can have it too. Because someday there may be, we all know how to make those things now, there may be a madman like a Hitler come along that would start making them quietly. Or, I didn't say this to him, very much in my mind, we'd always have to wonder whether they really had done away with all of theirs. And this way we wouldn't have to worry if we knew we had this thing. But I told him that we're prepared to write a treaty now that agrees to share with them at the point that we have totally eliminated the ballistic missiles and that we would not deploy. Well, I didn't add this either. My thought is that if we started to deploy while we still had offensive weapons, we would be at risk because before we could get it deployed, they would have to see that this would give us the capacity for a first strike if we could defend against them without retaliation and we had the offensive missiles. So rather than that, because we don't want that first strike capability, I said that this is what we would share. Now, if the day comes that we've got that and they won't go along, even with the offer of sharing, then after we've done and exhausted every effort to bring about this fulfillment, we'll deploy. We will not let them just simply by standing back, digging in their heels, do away or hold us hostage without using that system. But my dream of it is that it can be the means of eliminating the nuclear threat worldwide.
Mr. President, how can we as individuals best help you to accomplish the best and most for the continued and future success of our country, particularly in the area of judicial appointments and the economy?
Well, just exactly what you're set up to do. When we have the legislature against us, as we do in both houses, there are going to be times when we have to go to the people. And we have to be able to stand not alone as a president against the Congress majority, but as the president and the people. And I'll tell you, the vision that's in my mind is something that happened when I was governor, because I had the same situation there. We, in my second term, constructed the greatest welfare reform, the most comprehensive welfare reform that has ever been put in place in this country. And I was running into trouble with the legislature. They wouldn't play. So we quietly got people like yourselves out in the country to, in counties, to appoint county chairmen and to organize at the grassroots county organizations in support of the welfare reform. And one day I was sitting in my office and the door opened and the Speaker of the Assembly walked in, hands above his head, and said, "Stop those cards and letters." And we got the welfare reform. So this is where you come in, and that's what we'll have to do, is take our case many times. I know I'm going to have to take the case to the people about the line item veto, and I don't think we're going to get control of the budget until we have it. 43 governors have it. Why shouldn't the President of the United States be able to line item veto? Then it goes back to the Congress, and if they can override his veto. But you know something, in California, I line item vetoed 943 items out of the budget. 943 times in 8 years, was never overridden once. Now in California, it takes 2/3 of the legislature to pass the budget, and they had passed it. It only takes 2/3 to override my veto. But those pork barrel things that had been buried in the budget when they were exposed and had to be voted on a veto vote one at a time, no one would vote to override. Well, that's what I think the president ought to have. When all of America were kind of unofficial Notre Dame alumni. But on the other hand, I have to say for Coach Paterno at Penn State, he's one of those men that is not only a great football coach, but he has the interests of the boys at last question, let me just say, I know that all of you are sitting here filled with questions about, oh, there have been some delicate hints in the press media these last several days about having to do with the Middle East and Iran and hostages and so forth. All of it has been as phony as a $3 bill, and tonight at 8 o'clock, if you have an opportunity, I'm going on the air and tell what really was happening. Give you one little hint. We did not offer something to the terrorist camp.